from the University of Siegen in Germany. He's very well known for more than 20 years as a very specialist for handling inverse problems with aggressive and monotone operators. And yeah, I'm very happy that a couple of years ago he came back to this interesting topic and is now very active again in this field. And so I think it's one of the results there. It's your time.
Thank you. So first, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak here. And I'm very happy to be here after almost 26 years even here at IMPA. And well, the topic which I will speak about is a rather new one for me. And usually I'm been interested in linear problems, and now I'm working, try to work on nonlinear problems. And so the this is work still in progress, and the results are rather new here and are not published yet. And but I think it fits rather well to the topic of the conference. So I decided to speak about this. So. So I will consider a problem in a very abstract setting. So I will consider a nonlinear Ilpos problem in Hilbert spaces, in fact, and assume that the underlying operator is a monotone operator. So details will be given very soon. And what I will speak about is the regularization method, it's the so-called Lavrentiev regularization, or regularization by perturbation is another notation for this. And but I will consider a variant of this, so that's it's a variational formulation of this regularization method, in fact, which I will speak about. This is not a new topic. It's a rather old topic, I think, but considering convergence rates in that context is maybe not considered very often in the literature, I think, to my best knowledge. So here are some details. I will speak about the method first. So I will give some preparations and some basic notations. And in the second part of the talk, I will speak about the convergence results, or recall the convergence result first, and then I will speak about the rates. So here is the general setting of the problem. I will, as I mentioned before, I will consider an operator F, which is operating in a Hilbert space H, and which is assumed or allowed to be nonlinear in general. And what I will assume is that the operator is monotone at least on a subset of the Hilbert space H. So I will assume that on a given set M, a subset of H, this property here is satisfied. So this is the inner product in H, and I will assume that for elements belonging to M, we have U and V, we have this non-negative property. So this means that the operator F is monotone. And I will not consider any more assumptions on M. Monotone operators are often considered on the whole space. So in that case, M is equal to H. And then it's much easier to get results. But on the other hand, there are examples of monotone operators which are monotone on a real subset of H and not on the complete space. So this is reason enough to consider this setting here. So here is the first example, which is a linear one. I will speak about nonlinear problems in general, but anyway, so here's a monotone operator the classical integration operator on L2, for example, is monotone, or one could say accretive, on the whole space L2, and also the fractional powers of this operator, which are given over here. Fractional power means for exponents alpha between 0 and 1, they are defined like this. So this is the Abel operator, with the classical Abel operator obtained for alpha equal to b 1/2. This is also a monotone, or I could say accretive operator on the whole space L2. A non-symmetric operator, which makes things more complicated because there is no potential then. So this is one example, but of course, again, it's a linear example, and I will speak, I would like to consider nonlinear problems. And here is, are two nonlinear examples. In fact, the first one is a very simple parameter estimation problem for an ordinary differential equations on L2, which is considered here. It's the direct problem is a linear differential equation, a homogeneous one. I assume that the initial value is non-negative. And this defines a nonlinear mapping from U to F, which is one example which I have in mind in the following. And this is an example which was also considered in earlier papers, for example, by Ulrich Tautenhahn in the 90s. He claimed that this is a monotone operator on the whole space, which is not the case. So this is a monotone operator, but only on a subset of L2, so namely on the subset of non-negative or non-positive functions, I should say. So here we have a first example. I should mention also here in the beginning that things would be easier if M would be a ball, for example. So if it's not the whole space, and things would be easier if M would be a ball, or at least M would be have interior points. So which is not the case here. So if you consider such a subset of M, this does not have any interior points. The interior is empty. So this makes the analysis more complicated in a sense, which I would mention here already in the beginning, namely that the Lavrentiev equation does not have, it cannot be guaranteed that the Lavrentiev equation has a solution, in fact, in that situation. This is the problem which I would already mentioned here in the beginning, but you will see the details on the next one of the next transparencies, in fact. So here's another well-known, prominent example, I could say, the autoconvolution problem, which is considered in Chemnitz very often, and there are many experts there, and the operator is given here. Autoconvolution problem, which is also monotone, but monotone only on a subset of L2. Here is one possibility of a set M which could be considered in this context. Again, it's a non-symmetric operator. So non-symmetric means here, if you consider the Fréchet, the derivative, on special values of U, then you have a linear operator, which is again a Volterra operator, and this is not a symmetric operator. Okay. And these are my examples which I would like to present here. And it's a I should say for the second example, this is not highly nonlinear. It's a quadratic problem, in fact, but anyway, it's a nonlinear problem. Okay, so what I would like to consider now in a very general setting is an ill-posed equation f u equal to bf, where f is a monotone operator on M. F is defined here on the whole space H. This assumption could be reduced, so I would like to simplify the analysis right now here, and in general, it's not very hard to generalize this to a case where F is defined on the domain of definition, which completely contains the set M, of course. But to simplify things, I will consider it on the whole space H. So F is defined on the whole space H, but monotone only on the subset M equal VH. Typically, M is closed and convex. And H is in Hilbert space. And what I would like to consider here is the equation FU equal to BF. F is an element from H, and I assume that this equation has a solution, which is called here U star, and U star is assumed to be an element of M. So later on, I will consider variational inequalities. This is not the case here in the beginning, so I assume that indeed this problem has a classical solution. So no variational inequalities are considered right here. Another point is, of course, that we are here to consider ill-posed problems. So I assume that the inverse of f, if it has an inverse, in fact, may be unbounded. And I also assume that we have noisy data here with a known noise level. So I assume that instead of f, f delta is given with a distance to f which is smaller than delta, with a known value delta larger than zero. And we want to determine the u star. So this is the framework which I will assume to hold throughout the talk here in the following. And here's the classical Lavrentiev regularization. So the original equation is replaced by this equation, which contains a penalty term here. It's penalty term is given by multiply the identity by a factor gamma, small factor gamma, which is the regularization parameter. And we are looking for a solution of this regularization equation, which belongs to M. And stability of this regularization equation is not the topic here. But the main point is solvability. So it's not guaranteed in the general case that this equation has a solution if M is an arbitrary closed convex subset of H. If M is the whole space and the operator F is monotone and continuous, for example, then it's a maximal monotone operator, and you can be sure that this equation has a solution. But if M is small, for example, space of non-negative functions in L2, then this is not sure that this equation has indeed a solution. So before I will speak about the variational formulation, I will, not everybody is familiar with Lavrentiev regularization. It's quite similar to Tikhonov regularization, which I will consider here only for as an example in the linear case. So if you have a linear bounded operator on a Hilbert space, H1 to H2, for example, H1 and H2 are Hilbert spaces, as everybody knows, you can regularize the equation AU to be equal to BF in such a form with some small regularization parameter gamma, which has to be chosen appropriately, of course, in terms of the given noise. And as you can see, Lavrentiev regularization is very similar to Tikhonov regularization, but it avoids the normalization. And avoiding normalization is often very makes sense. In particular, for example, if you have Volterra equations, you will destroy the structure, the Volterra structure, if you apply normalization to the equation. So, in such equations, it makes sense to try to work with the original equation without any normalization. Another example is if the original problem is already symmetric, it does not make sense to apply the adjoint of the operator to both sides. You can already work with the original equation. So these are two examples in a linear case where it is convenient and can be recommended, in fact, to use this Lavrentiev regularization here in that form. Okay, so, but again, the problem is solvability of this equation for arbitrary closed convex sets. And I already mentioned the case if M is to the whole space, then you can be sure that this, under very moderate conditions on F, that this equation has a solution. Another option is if the M is a closed ball, which has sufficiently large radius, then you can also be sure that this equation has a solution. So Andreas Neubauer has communicated such some results on that. I think it was more or less private communication. And anyway, so we have solvability here. But as I mentioned before, I'm not interested in that case and also not interested in that case, but rather in that case over here, or maybe variants of it. So I'm interested in the sets of non-negative functions in L2, or non-positive functions would be a variant, or you could consider also derivatives, of course. And now to I will use in the sequel, in the following, I will use some abbreviation for the regularized version, which is here simply denoted by F gamma, with gamma a small positive regularization parameter, which of course is again an operator from H into H, but of course again monotone only on M, strictly monotone then in fact, which provides stability, but solvability of course is the problem over here. And instead of the equation which was considered over here, again we can use a variational formulation of this, and this looks like this is given over here. So this is without the gamma here, if gamma is equal to be zero, then this would be a variational formulation of our original problem over here. So we are looking for a solution u gamma delta, if gamma is larger than zero or equal to be zero. I'm looking for a solution u gamma delta, which belongs to M, such that an equality is satisfied for each u belonging to M. So, and this is what I understand under with a variation in Lavrentiev regularization. I could say this is a regularization or regularized version of the variational inequality. So here, this is the reason for using this abbreviation here, RBI, which I will use in the following. So this is a regularized variational inequality. So there is a characterization of this inequality over here. So if M PM denotes the metric projection onto the closed convex set, which of course exists, then U gamma delta is a solution to the problem above, to the REI, if and only if the solution, or this U gamma delta, is a solution to this fixed point equation. So you can, of course, reformulate the original equation, this is the Lavoisier equation, by into a fixed point equation, which is simply this without the projection operator PM in front of this. And then this, of course, if the original equation has not a solution, then the fixed point equation has also not a solution on M. And the, but you can put a convex projection, of course, in front of this fixed point equation here on the right-hand side. And it's easy to see that the original variational, regularized variational inequality is equivalent to this fixed point equation with the convex projection in front of it. And so you can, of course, hope that this new equation, this new problem, has a fixed point, or this RVI has a solution. And in fact, under very moderate conditions on the operator F, you can be sure that such a solution indeed exists. So for example, if F is continuous and bounded operator, then it can be shown by classical, as a classical result, in fact, by Brazis, for example, that then our RVI problem has indeed a solution. It has a new, unique solution, but uniqueness is not the topic here, because the uniqueness follows from the strict monotonicity of the regularized operator. But the main point is that it has a solution in this under this conditions. So the conditions can be relaxed, of course. So for example, you can, for instance, for experts, you can replace the continuous by demi-continuous, which is a property that the operator F maps strong convergent sequences into weak convergent sequences. So you can relax the conditions here on the continuity of the operator F, of course. And what I is not cannot be read here, but of course I assume, still assume, that the operator F is monotone on this given subset M, which is to assume to be closed and convex. So this is a general assumption, of course, here in the following. Okay, so now we can be sure that there is such a U gamma delta for each choice of gamma bigger than zero. And now the question is this a regularization method? Can gamma be chosen in dependence of delta such that we have convergence to the solution U star of the original problem? And so here's a typical illustration of semi-convergence, which of course also holds for the RVI problem. And problem is to appropriately choose the parameter gamma. And the first step for the analysis of the convergence of the method is simply to decompose the error in a way like this. And this estimate here, this is obtained, so this lemma. So here we have, before I indicate why this is a true result, I should indicate here that the decomposition is in such a way that we have here the error for the unperturbed problem, so the U gamma here is U gamma 0, in fact, so delta is equal to be 0, so this means the solution to the RVI, to the regularized variation inequality, if we have no perturbation in the data, plus the term which comes from the error propagation. So the estimate over here in the lemma comes from this decomposition, and it's very easy, of course, to estimate the error propagation. This is for a monotone problem, can be estimated in a very standard way by the noise level delta divided by the realization parameter gamma. And you can see, of course, if gamma is chosen too small, then the error is propagated too much. And but on the other hand, you have to choose the gamma small enough in order to have the bias. This is the realization error for the unperturbed problem, in order to have the bias small enough. So in the analysis, this part here is not the problem. And on the main target is now to estimate the realization error for the unperturbed problem, so to estimate the bias, in fact. This is the only task here. And the rest is standard, and it's balancing of the of both terms, in fact. Well, here I'm recording some results on convergence, so no convergence rates here. Let us denote by U star the minimum norm solution of the non-regularized variational inequality. So gamma equal to be zero. So this is a little bit different than to assume that U star is the problem of the original equation. So here, indeed, we assume that U star is minimum norm solution of the BI, of the variational inequality. Then it can be shown, or was shown many years ago, in fact, by Albert and Jan Zeva, for example, that the realization error goes to zero as gamma goes to zero for the unperturbed problem. And for the perturbed problem, you have realization if the parameter gamma delta, gamma is now chosen in dependence of delta, so we denote it by gamma delta, in such a way that it goes to zero on one side, and on the other side, it goes not to zero too fast. So in such a sense over here, these are the standard assumptions, or on a a priori parameter choice, I should say. In order to get a realization method over here. So there are many results in that direction, generalizations, for example, with respect to the considered sets. Here are some names are mentioned over here. But convergence rates are not considered very often, to my knowledge at least. And so I will speak about this next, and this is then my result here for this talk. This is valid only for a subclass of the considered problem. So I will speak about a class, the co-coercive operators now, and assume that the operator F is co-coercive on the given subset M, which means that we can estimate the inner product, which is also considered for the monotonicity. Now we assume a little bit more than monotonicity. We assume that this inner product can be estimated below by this term over here. So this does not mean well-posedness, so we can assume that the operator F is ill-posed, but anyway, it's an additional assumption. Obviously, every co-coercive operator is monotone on the subset M. And obviously, or very, you can derive immediately by considering SWOT inequality, it's easy to see that the operator co-coercive implies that F is a Lipschitz continuous operator. So, but there is some kind of converse result. If the operator F is, has a potential, which unfortunately is not written here, but it's an important assumption, so F has to be an antiderivative. And if the set M is open and F is Lipschitz continuous, then conversely, the operator F is also co-coercive. So to say that this indicates that this is not a very strong condition. But on the other hand, from my example, we do not have the property that F has a potential, because we I was interested in Volterra operators, and so this is not satisfied here for my example. There are operators which are not co-coercive. So if you consider a very simple example, a linear operator, which is a rotation, then these inner product is always zero. So the operator is monotone, but it's not co-coercive. So it's indeed restriction. Yeah, so, but this is needed in the analysis. Following analysis for obtaining convergence rates. And here are the basic result, in fact. So what I assume is that the operator F is co-coercive on M. It is Fréchet differentiable on H, which again can be relaxed, this condition. But I can say here it's sufficient if the operator is Fréchet differentiable on a domain of definition which is open and contains the closed convex set M. But for simplicity, I assume here that the operator F is Fréchet differentiable on the whole space H. And the Fréchet differentiable derivative is assumed to be Lipschitz continuous on H. And now there is some smoothness assumptions. Of course, you know that we cannot obtain rates without any additional assumption on the solution. So this is given over here. We assume that U star can, the solution which we are looking for, can be represented in a form like this over here. So it's assumed to be to belong to the range of F star at the U star itself and the adjoint of S. So here, star here over means the adjoint operator of the Fréchet derivative of the operator F at the solution U star. And the element Z, which is considered over here, is assumed to be to have a norm which is small enough, in fact. In that case, one can show that, this is the main result here of my talk, one can show that the bias, so this is the regularization error for the unperturbed problem, goes to zero in such a way that it can be estimated by square root of gamma. And you can also estimate the residual, but that's not the main point. Of course, we are interested in the estimate for the bias, in fact. And this result improves some known results. There is some paper by Liu and Neschet which are considering regularized rational inequalities, in fact, almost 20 years ago. And they obtained convergence rates under some similar assumptions on U star, but only gamma to the 1 over 3. So they consider slightly more general setting, so more general sets, in fact, they allow also perturbation in the set dependent on the delta, so which is not the case here. I consider M to be constant, independent of delta, so to say. And but under these conditions over here, I can prove that we have this approved convergence rate. Similar rates were obtained also for Lavoisier factorization, for example, here in the paper which is mentioned over here, and but for the classical Lavoisier factorization. So, for example, if you consider M to be equal to BH, you can obtain such a rate, but once again, I consider here a more specific situation. The results are not optimal for the linear case, as you mentioned over here, but here I'm considering nonlinear problems. So this is my, of course, two more transparencies. Of course, now if you have an estimate for the bias, you can calculate a priori parameter choice for gamma delta like this over here, and you get an estimate for the overall error in terms like this over here with an exponent for the delta 1/3, 1/3. So this is what I wanted to say here in my talk. Here are some conclusions. I would be interested in getting more examples, for example, or the Kokor surfaceness is not easy to verify for the problem, so it would be good to relax this condition. I'm also interested in generalizing some other results, for example, by Janu, considered the autoconvolution problem. Here I'm interested in, and so many thanks again for giving me the opportunity to speak here, and many thanks for the attention. Thank you.